I'm setting out on a mission to find whatever technology is behind the Tic Tac UAP. There's a lot to unpack here, so I'm just going to do it all in real time to the best of my ability. I stumbled upon a company by the name of Proceris Technologies, and this company is one that Lockheed Martin actually acquired, I think in 2016. But what's interesting about Proceris is that they specialize in UAVs, unmanned aerial vehicles. They specialize in specific capabilities such as swarming. Swarming is when you have a lot of different drones essentially ambush its target. And, you know, I became interested in Proceris because it seemed like a likely candidate and an actual prime suspect for the 2004 Nimitz encounter. And let me explain why. Not only was Proceris acquired by Lockheed, which itself is, I would argue, a prime suspect behind multiple UAP sightings, but Proceris was actually founded in 2004, the very same year that the Nimitz UAP encounter occurred. And not only that, but Proceris happened to be testing its UAP or its UAV capabilities at that very same time.
At Lockheed Martin, Proceris Technologies, we're very excited about our new quadrotor VTOL platform because it represents for the first time our foray into actually building a small UAS platform.
I mean, so many of the Nimitz witnesses described to me in my interviews with them that these UAVs were essentially flying in a cluster. They were flying in some sort of loose formation. And it was almost a swarm of drones. And you see here that Navy engineers are trying to develop swarms of unmanned aerial vehicles. And these are mainly going to carry out reconnaissance exercises for the military. But it's not too unlikely that these types of capabilities might have been tested on unwitting subjects. This part gave me the chills when I first discovered it. The Joint Unmanned Combat Air System program began being managed by DARPA, but was handed off to a joint U.S. Navy and Air Force office in October 2005. October 2005 was less than a year after the Nimitz Tic Tac UFO. In March 2004, the X-45A completed a 10-day schedule of test flights. So in 2004, I want to repeat that, there was a 10-day schedule of test flights. Lo and behold, these test flights happened at Edwards Air Force Base in California. Edwards, California, not too far from the coast of San Diego. Bear in mind, these test flights would have been happening at virtually the exact same time. It's just weird to me that there were test flights happening in the same place at the same time, and we're gonna pretend that the Nimitz couldn't have been a test flight. Okay, here's another example of drones being tested in Utah. And they're being tested for hours and hours in the air at a time. So when you hear people say, how could these drones be airborne for so many hours? Here's a documented example of drones that were airborne for 11 hours in total. Three drones were actually airborne for 7 hours. I mean, that's pretty impressive. So these drones can really stay up there for a long period of time. This one's really eerie. The drones were programmed to engage their targets before returning to the airspace around the mothership to be recaptured and carried home. So, I mean, that sounds to me a lot like the 2015 encounters off the East Coast with the gimbal video.
There's a whole fleet of them. Look on the ASA. Oh my gosh. They're all going against the wind. The wind's 120 knots to the west. Look at that thing, dude.
We had, according to the pilots, a whole fleet of smaller objects flying in front of this much larger object, which has been described by a lot of folks as a mothercraft. I mean, it's not to say that this couldn't have been ET. The gimbal video to me looks pretty exotic, but I mean, if the military is documented that it's testing this same capability where smaller drones can go into a larger ship, then we can't rule out the possibility that it's our own. According to Lockheed Martin, the company has an innovative laser power system that has extended its drone's flight time to up to 48 hours. These things can stay in the air for 48 hours. As far back as 2003, Lockheed Martin stated that its supersonic program was well in development. The test flights were scheduled in November. Like, all of them were scheduled in November. And a lot of them were scheduled right off the coast of Southern California. I implore anyone who's interested, pull up any of these press releases from these Lockheed Martin test flights in 2003 and 2004, where they tested pretty much supersonic drones that can fly from 50,000 feet down to 15,000 feet. They can fly in fleets. They're very hard to detect. They're elusive. They fly with unconventional propulsion systems at times. I mean, there are very many consistencies between both the East Coast and the West Coast sightings, and very few inconsistencies. Look at the words used here. There was even an intercept aircraft involved. Sounds a lot like Commander Fravor's intercept. Getting really into the weeds here, Raptor 7 is one of seven developmental flight test aircraft currently operating from Edwards Air Force Base, California. If you're looking for consistencies between Lockheed's prototypes and the Nimitz Tic Tac, look no further than this press release. A unique propulsion system with the ability to fly at hypersonic speeds and hover. Lockheed Martin holds the patent on the heart of the propulsion system, the shaft-driven lift fan, which multiplies lifting force. The aircraft conducted supersonic test flights as far back as 2001. Let's get into some of the history here, figure out what the hell's going on with Lockheed and Proceris. So Lockheed acquired Proceris in 2012, so beginning of Obama's second term. And in between the West Coast and East Coast sightings, Proceris is a pretty small company, and they're founded in 2004. And here's another interesting tidbit that probably warrants a video in itself. Proceris was born in 2002 at Brigham Young University, BYU. And as it turns out, BYU and Lockheed Martin have this really close-knit relationship, almost a revolving door, where you have a lot of engineers working on drone technologies at BYU. They then graduate with jobs at Lockheed Martin, working in these classified programs on top secret technologies. So there's no doubt some connection between Brigham Young University, Utah, Lockheed Martin, and UAPs. Utah was perhaps positioned from the very beginning to become a leader in drone technology thanks to its access to long stretches of flat, straight, uninhabited highway, and political leaders who worked to champion the drone industry in Utah. And of course, Lockheed Martin was one of the very first ones testing drones in Utah. Again, our second suspect, Brigham Young University, appears. BYU has a Center for Unmanned Aircraft Systems and a very cozy relationship with the U.S. Air Force. Since the early 2000s, BYU has been working with the Air Force to help develop these unmanned aircrafts. What curious timing, the same year as the Nimitz Tic Tac UFO, Proceris Technologies emerged from BYU before garnering the interest of the U.S. Air Force and, of course, Lockheed Martin. The Department of Defense for decades now has been engaged with military-industrial complex partners at top-secret facilities like the Nevada Test and Training Range, aka Area 51, all the way to Beaver, Utah, all the way to the coast of San Diego. They've been testing top-secret technologies with military applications in the hope of leapfrogging our adversaries in complete secrecy. A two-week series of demonstration flights conducted by Lockheed Skunk Works. And it should come as no surprise to the Navy that Lockheed Martin has hypersonic flight capabilities, because Lockheed Martin was hired by the Navy to develop hypersonic flight capabilities. For those who say we didn't have these types of capabilities back then, in 2002, 2 years before the Nimitz, right off the coast of California as well, off of Edwards Air Force Base, we were testing very similar capabilities. And while these particular aircraft have the DARPA logo, one could imagine that without any branding, a white-labeled version of this prototype could look semi-Tic Tac-ish. Again, just to recap, we've established that Lockheed Martin has proprietary, unique propulsion systems. These propulsion systems have been around as early as 2000. Remember when people made a big deal that $22 million went to the Advanced Aerospace Threat Identification Program, ATIP? Well, $22 million is a drop in the bucket when you consider that Lockheed Martin wins billion-dollar contract after $100 million contract after billion-dollar contract after $100 million contract pretty much every single week of the entire year.
Like, ride with me if you ride with me. You can slide with me if you feel like. 550 on the 5 sticky, come get high with me, that's a deal, right? Ride with me if you ride with me, you can slide with me if you feel like. 550 on the 5 sticky, come get high with me, that's a deal, right? That's a deal, right? That's a bet, right?
This one's maybe my favorite headline because it's pretty much a giveaway that Lockheed is behind a lot of these UAP sightings. NASA hands massive supersonic contract to Lockheed Martin with one catch: no sonic boom. Remember the question, how could these things be flying at supersonic speeds and not be making a sonic boom? You gotta ask Lockheed Martin and you gotta ask NASA because they're the ones who have the answer. Much like with artificial intelligence, people tend to think that these really cutting-edge technologies are further off than they actually are. And similarly, hypersonic technologies tend to be thought of as science fiction, when in reality, they're science fact. And I was surprised to learn that you don't need a top-secret security clearance to be privy to this. Lockheed Martin and the Air Force have long ago disclosed that they're working on hypersonic weapons. They're not just working on them, but they're mastering them. The hypersonic weapons are going to be able to reach speeds of at least Mach 5, or 5 times the speed of sound, with one catch. Remember, no sonic boom. And it's not just the US testing hypersonic vehicles. In 2004, Russia also tested its first hypersonic vehicle, meaning that we can't take the foreign adversary theory off the table entirely. Now, I'm much more prone to believe that this craft originated here from the US from a company like Proceris within Lockheed Martin, and I have test flight after test flight and prototype after prototype and even time and place aligning to prove that. But what I don't have is a smoking gun. And for that reason, we can't take any other theory off the table, and that means extraterrestrial, that also means foreign adversary. We know that Russia is surveilling us and spying on us and trying to gain a military advantage. So I would name Russia, just like I'm naming Proceris, as one of the prime suspects. Bringing things closer to home, the Pentagon releases results 13,000 mile per hour test flight over the Pacific. And another prime suspect here has got to be DARPA. DARPA is the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, which is really just the research arm of the Pentagon. And so we know what the Pentagon does from a military standpoint. It does a whole lot of research, most of which is applied to the military, but it's done in partnership with companies like Lockheed Martin. And pay attention to these very specific performance capabilities. The flight successfully demonstrated stable aerodynamically controlled flight at speeds up to Mach 20 for nearly 3 minutes. Now, Commander Fravor didn't even encounter the Tic Tac for more than 3 minutes, unless I'm mistaken. It wasn't too much longer than that. And if this particular craft could display those types of performance capabilities for 3 minutes, what's to think that another craft couldn't display similar characteristics for 6 minutes or 7 minutes? Now, I don't want to put all the criticism or even all the credit, if this turns out to be a breakthrough, on Lockheed, because there are a lot of other players here, such as Boeing and Raytheon and, of course, DARPA, but I can't help but notice that Lockheed, time and time again, is suspect numero uno. And we just can't rule out that this Tic Tac UFO wasn't a hypersonic prototype being tested, because we have documented here that these prototypes were being tested as early as 2004. One vehicle reportedly has a long, wide, flat shape. A long, wide, flat shape. That sounds somewhat like a disc, somewhat like a saucer. And the other vehicle has a more traditional cylindrical shape. Cylindrical, that sounds somewhat like a Tic Tac. One of the funniest and probably most frustrating things about all of this, if it does turn out that Lockheed is behind these UAP sightings, is that Lockheed has been anything but secretive. I mean, of course they have with Skunk Works, but I mean, they've been announcing that they're a significant player in the hypersonic tech space for 30 years. That means that any UAP sighting within the last 30 years that was considered anomalous because of its speed has to be considered within the context that Lockheed Martin has hypersonic capabilities. What is it about this company that keeps me coming back to their homepage? Reading over their capabilities and departments? Why does Senator Harry Reid think that Lockheed Martin might be in the possession of a UFO? Senator Reid was not just a United States Senator, one of 100, but he was the Senate Majority Leader. He told The New Yorker, that for decades, he heard that Lockheed had some of these retrieved materials. And he tried to get access, he tried to get classified approval by the Pentagon to go look at it. But like many, his access was not granted, and his efforts were futile. It turns out that Lockheed only opened up about Skunk Works when it came under pressure, and it used to be much more secretive than it is today. But I wouldn't get overly optimistic that Lockheed is ever going to open up about any of these secrets or any of these top secret programs, because they're kind of their whole bread and butter, and it's why the US military trusts them, and it's why our foreign governments are probably trying to surveil them and gain a competitive advantage. The last point to mention is that Lockheed Skunk Works has been around since 1954. So while it's not quite as old as the Roswell sightings, it could in fact explain some of the sightings as old as the 1950s. Now, I'm not trying to crush anyone's hopes. In fact, I'm leaving a ton of room out there for the extraterrestrial hypothesis. I think it's one of the most compelling hypotheses out there. But I also think the terrestrial hypothesis is particularly compelling when you consider the history of Lockheed Martin and its Skunk Works program, and now the Procerus Technologies Division. As we look to the stars and imagine what's possible on other planets, we can't forget what's possible on Mars.